So, good afternoon. I welcome you for the seventh lecture where we are going to look at now finding out the resultant of Space Force system, which is neither concurrent nor parallel, right? So, let me take an example problem for the same and explain you. So, let me share or look at this shared screen. So, let us have now. This is lecture number. Resultant of general space force system. Why did I go straight away for the general space force system is because you would easily solve for a concurrent space force system. So what would be the resultant of concurrent space force system? It is resultant will be summation of force vectors. So if I have say five forces acting on a rigid body, but all the five forces has got a common point of intersection, then the system is concurrent. But five forces are not in one single plane, they are come out of it. So for example, look at an aesthetic lamp supported by five cables on the ceiling. So the tensions in all the cables are the five forces that you can assume along with the weight. So all are concurrent force, and concurrent point is the point light itself. So if you have that, it is easy to find out the resultant. So every force I have to represent by its Cartesian vector form. So you know to represent the magnitude of a force as a Cartesian vector, two points in the line are the unit vector straight away given. So if we are knowing two points in the line, you can represent the line by unit vector. Hence, you can represent the force vector. It is addition of force vector is what is resultant straight away. So it's easier. That's why I have not taken a problem to explain. I leave it to you as a self-study content. I would pose some problems to do that in a tutorial. And similarly, parallel space force system. So parallel space force system, if we look at again, can be an example of a huge machinery which is erected on the ground with the support mounts. So the contact point of the machine with the ground is say four points. So all the four points there are mounts. So entire weight of that machinery is now, entire weight of the machine is now supported by four foundation bolts. So there are four loads. So the four loads resultant, if I ask you to find out, you would be able to find out simply because they are parallel, simply addition of the vectors. If the foundation is parallel and it is on XY plane, the vectors are pointing in Z axis. So it is simply addition of all magnitudes times K vector is what is resultant. But again, the difference between concurrent space force system and parallel space force system, it would be the point of application of resultant. The resultant vector will be the lamp itself, concurrent point itself in case of concurrent force system. It's very straightforward. Whereas for a parallel force system, it is not so. So you have to apply Waring-Nance theorem. So whatever that you have seen in coplanar system force, you would apply that and you'll be able to find the point of application of the resultant. So you'll see that also later on, and it's a simple compared to the problem that I'm going to take for a general space force system. So when you have to do a general space force system, and today at the end of this period, you will understand two things. One is you will be clear with an application of equivalent force couple system. Another one, you would understand what do you mean by wrench. So these two aspects you will understand. And if you understand this, then only you would be able to find out resultant of general space force system. Best example is a passenger car. So you have weight at the CG location, you have aerodynamic force in the center of the projected area of the frontal projected area, you have tractive force in the tire contact patch, and those forces are not in one tire, it is in different place. So there are various forces acting in space, and they are at a different point of application on the rigid body, and they are neither parallel nor concurrent. So that is a classical example of general space force system. And how do you replace all of them by a single force is what is that I am going to teach. In that process, you will understand these two things, right? So I am going to take not a passenger car and put all the forces, and you know, time may not be sufficient. I am going to take a simple example. Let us understand the concept first, and then you can extend that understanding for any real-time problems. So for that matter, I am going to look at a solid, which is a tetrahedron. So this tetrahedron is referred by two axes. See, this is, let me just use the same coordinate orientation, x, y, z, what is that I have used. Yeah, so this axis is my y axis, this axis is my z axis, and obviously then this is my x-axis. So in this x-axis I have this representation of this solid. Right, so this is that solid now. So let me name that solid as A, B, C. So this is the tetrahedron, and these coordinates are given. Now A is along x-axis 3 units, 0, 0, that much say meters. And along B axis, I have, it is 2 units along along Y axis, so 0, 2, 0. And here it is 2 units along this 0, 0, 2. So I have these 3 points coordinates, and if I consider this vertex of the tetrahedron as origin, 0, 0, 0. So I have a tetrahedron OABC. It is not a regular tetrahedron. It is tetrahedron has got a 4 faces triangle. So that's why I call this as a tetrahedron. A regular tetrahedron should have an identical triangle, so equilateral triangle. This is all, you know, the different solid definitions. In this tetrahedron, I'm going to represent the system of forces. So what is that system of force? I have 3 forces acting now on this tetrahedron. So one is the force which is acting along x-axis from point A. Say this is 100 Newton force. Let me call that as F1 force, 100 Newton. The another one is the force acting at point B. It is acting through towards B. So I have this force from point C towards B. This is 200 Newton, say F2 force, 200 Newton. Right, and then the third force is along z axis from this point C vertically upward. So this is my F3 force, which is 300 newton. So now I need to replace the 3 forces by a single force and find the resultant, right? So what does that see? Look at now these 3 forces constitute which category? Is it the category 1 or category 2 or today's class problem category 3, general space force system? Can anyone answer? Aravind?
Yes sir, I'm here. So
is it falls in which category? Is it a concurrent space force system or parallel space force system or a general space force system problem?
So general space.
Yeah, because you see these two, F3 and F2 has got a common intersection. Similarly, F3 and F1 has got a common intersection if I extend the line of action of the force. But all 3 are not having a common intersection, so it is not concurrent space force system. And they are not parallel, so it is not parallel force system. So neither concurrent nor parallel is called the general force system, and 2 forces are in one plane, y, z, whereas the other forces out of this plane along is the x-axis, so it is space force system. So when you have like this, three forces spread in space, neither concurrent nor parallel, you have to find the resultant at a point. So the convenient point is, if we have a number of forces, more number of forces having a common intersection, then you choose that point. So like we have done it in an earlier class also. So this point B is what I will choose. So find the resultant at point B. What is it I'm going to do? Resultant at point B, I'm going to do, right? At this point. So what is that finally I'm going to draw here is, I will have this tetrahedron. This tetrahedron, I will have my resultant acting at, what is my resultant? Point B. That's what I'm going to do. So how do I do that? I would have here as a resultant force and resultant couple. Why? Because I know this F2 has got its line of action through this point B. So I can extend this force F2 along this line and I can have that force here. So let me do that. The force here is this. Extend. That is what is principle of transmissibility of force. If a force is acting on a single rigid body, I can slide the force along the line of action. So this is my F2 force, which is 200 Newton. And other two forces, I cannot bring it to point B. To bring this force 100 Newton to point B, what is that I should do? Can I just bring it here and write it like this? This is now parallel to x-axis. So can I put this force here, F1, 100 Newton, and F3 perpendicular. So can I write it here? Can I put this vector here? This is 300 Newton. This is F3 force. Can I just put it? I can bring this all forces like that, but when I bring this force here, it will be brought along with a couple. That is what is equivalent force couple system that we have learned in the previous classes. So how do I do that? So if I have to shift this force, let me take now for F1 force, I put this F1 force as it is at point B, F1, and I cancel that force by 100 F1. So now what has happened? This two cancels, I have these three forces only. That's the meaning. So in a system of forces, I can add a force and I can cancel the force by the same magnitude at the same point, opposite sense, like this. So that does not change the effect of force on the body. So by doing so, what does happen? I have to look at now this force and this force. So these two forces are parallel now, same magnitude but opposite sense. So that forms a couple. So the force at point A can be shifted to point B like this, but it will be brought along with a couple. So now couple moment is how much it is? Couple moment. So since now these two forces in the XY plane, it is convenient. So and look at now right hand rule, put four fingers along the direction of F1 forming the couple, either of that. So if I take this force and put my four fingers and try to curl it, my thumb comes perpendicular to XY in positive Z direction. So I have my couple moment at point B as I shift this force F1 from point A to B, acting at point B in positive Z direction. So I would put that couple moment here as well. So I'll draw this vector here. And couple moment, so I put two arrows. So this is now going to be how much? So since this distance is known now, it is 2. So it is 100 into 100, 200. So 200 K is what is M2. Why do I put M2? This is due to force M2. Due to force M1, sorry. This is the M1, let me call. This is the M1. So how does it been obtained actually? By definition, it should be ROB cross at point B, ROB cross F1. ROB cross F1 is what is that I get. So I have this 200 Newton force couple. So I have shifted this and that associate. So these two are perpendicular now. Clear? Similarly, what would happen if I shift this 300 Newton force? So look at now, I'll use the different color here for this. So I have this F3, that F3 can be brought here. And that same F3 can be cancelled. This is F3. This is F3. So now look at this F3 and this F3. So that forms a couple. And that is in YZ plane. And the find, to find out the direction, I can put in either one of these fours arrow direction. So if I take this one, it goes inside the x-axis. If I take this one also, it goes, thumb goes inside YZ plane. So I have negative moment here into I. So how much it is again? 300 into this moment arm. That's two distance here. So I would have that in x direction. Negative x direction. So I will have here this couple moment, and that would be equal to how much? 300 into 2. So 600, that's minus I. That is my M3. There is no M2 because the line of action of force F2 passes through point B itself. So there is no couple there. So I have now two couples and three forces at point B. So that's my resultant. That's my resultant. So what I have to do to find out resultant, I should add the force vectors, I should add the moment vector, and I have my answer. So I would have this again, see how many times, how different ways that we can represent a resultant. So this is equivalent again. This is equivalent again, like this. Right. So let me take again the tetrahedron. So this is my point B. At point B, I would have my resultant vector, and I would also have my force vector. Moment vector, sorry, couple vector. So that couple vector direction I do not know, just arbitrarily draw here my couple vector. That's my M vector. And there will be an included angle between them. So these two, this angle theta that I can find out. So this angle is 90 degrees, or if this angle is less than 90 degrees or greater than 90 degrees, that we can find out. So this can vary from zero, between 0 and 180 degrees. Right? So what is that angle theta also I can find out. So now let us find out what is my resultant vector R. That's F1 vector plus F2 vector plus F3 vector. So whatever now I'm doing, that is that for a concurrent system. If my given forces only are at a point like these three forces, I have my magnitude, and if I represent my vector in a Cartesian form, I get my resultant vector. So what is my F1 vector? So F1 vector is along x-axis. I have taken this for a simplicity to solve quickly this problem in this period. So 100i. What is my F2 vector? 200, but it is pointing from C to B. So that would be 200 times RCB by modulus of RCB, right? That's a unit vector. Plus what is my F3 vector? Perpendicular to z-axis, positive. So it is 300k. So I have to just work out this simply. So this is 100i. Plus 200 into. So bc. So b is this, c is this. So b, 0 minus 0, 2 minus 0, 2i. Sorry, 2j. 0 minus 2k. By root of 4 plus 4 under root 8. So this is a unit vector times this and plus 300k. So that's going to be 100i plus 200 into 400 by root 8. Root 8, how much it is? 400 by root 8. j, and minus 400 by root 8 plus 300 plus 300 minus 400 by root 8 times k. So it's my resultant r vector. So you can work out what is the answer here for this. What is the answer for r vector? I have, what is the answer? R vector. So 100i plus 141.42j. 100i plus 141.42j plus 300 minus this value would be 300 minus this value would be 158.58k. That's my resultant vector. Equivalent force and coupled system here. So what is my moment vector? Now, m vector, that is m1 plus m3. Because m2 is not there, so that's going to be, what is that we have found out? So what is that we have found out? M1 is 200k and m2 is minus 600. I, M3 is minus 600, M1 200K and minus 600 I. So that's going to be minus 600 I plus 200K. That's my coupled vector. So at point B, you have resultant force and couple given by this. Your problem doesn't end here if you are representing, because you have to understand what you mean by range and so on. So how do you understand that? For that, let us work out this problem further, finding out what is this angle theta. So now this angle theta, how do I find out? I can use my cross product, dot product application. So two vector A dot B is what? AB cos theta. So I have R vector and M vector. So R dot M vector would be modulus of R, modulus of M cos theta. So theta would be cos inverse of R dot M by modulus of R, modulus of M. So cos inverse of R dot M is what? Minus 600 into 100. So that's minus this, and plus 200 into 158.58. So 200 into 158.58. This all divided by, because there's no j here, and the root of this square plus this magnitude square. Right, magnitude of R is what? This R. I have to put here in detail. So what is this radical sign going to be? Under root of 100 square plus 141.42 square plus 158.58 square. This is for modulus of resultant, resultant. Multiplied by modulus of this multiplication sign by modulus of this, that is 600 square plus 200 square. So this would solve for my angle theta. And what is the angle theta? Anybody is solving parallelly with me? Can anyone answer? What is the angle theta? So the angle theta is 101 degrees. So I get minus 0.19044. So this, if I work out, this comes out to be cos inverse of minus 0.19041. So that, if I solve cos inverse of this whatever value is there, that's going to be 101 degrees. So it is with an obtuse angle theta, right? Obtuse angle theta. So when you are asked to find the resultant at that point B, what I would do, I would find R vector, I would find M vector, and I need to find out angle between these two as well. Then you can stop here for finding the resultant. But also I have told at the beginning, you need to understand what is this concept of wrench. So wrench is a vector, which is wrench is a force vector and couple vector, which is represented in a collinear fashion. So look at the moment vector. How do you get? You get a force vector. It's moment about the point when you take. You get a moment vector perpendicular to plane containing force vector and the position vector. So you see, when you take a moment of a force about a point or line, you do not have a collinear component of moment along with this. For example, when you shifted this 300 Newton force, so 300 Newton force is this, but its moment or the couple moment is perpendicular to this. So these two, this is perpendicular here. Similarly, when you had this 100 Newton force, the moment is perpendicular to this. They are not collinear. But if we have a force and a moment which is collinear, that's what is called a wrench. So I can get that in this case. In this case of the resultant. So what I can, how do I get that? If I resolve this moment vector, one along this line of action, one perpendicular to the line of action, I did that. The one component which is along the resultant line of action is the collinear couple and moment, and the other one is perpendicular moment component of this moment, the resultant couple, and that can be eliminated if I shift the force vector, the resultant force and the couple parallel to this, to another point, say point P, and that is how I can represent, reduce this further to a system called a wrench. So wrench is a force vector and a couple vector collinear. So how do I get that? So that's what I'm going to just explain you. And for that, and that would complete today's lecture. So it's now another 5 minutes, I'll finish it. In case you are hurry for the next lecture, you can proceed. I will download the attendance. But I will finish this and upload this video lecture. Those who miss can find out. Right, so look at now the moment vector M can be represented as, the couple vector what we have found can be represented as couple vector parallel to the resultant vector plus couple vector perpendicular to resultant vector. I can represent it like this. So how do I get the couple vector parallel to resultant vector? It is simple. The dot product times the unit vector of the resultant vector line. So that would be written like this. How can I write that? As M vector dot unit vector of the resultant vector times unit vector of this resultant. So this is what is going to be this one. And what is this perpendicular component? That's going to be simply R cross. R cross R vector. R cross R vector. Right, so now this can be looked at again here. This moment vector dot this would give me, I'm rewriting this. What is my unit vector along the resultant vector? It is modulus of resultant by, resultant vector by its modulus. I get this unit vector. So I know the resultant vector, divide by its modulus, I get unit vector along the resultant direction. And again, I multiply that with the R vector by modulus of R vector, as this is there here outside as well, plus R cross R vector. So again, I see this as, except this R vector, rest all I bring it together. So it is m vector, couple vector dot r vector divided by modulus of r into modulus of r, that's r squared into r vector. Right? So plus r cross r vector. So what does this, you see, dot product by modulus square. So this is what is called pitch of the range times r vector plus r cross r vector.
Sir, I have a different class to attend, sir. It's 3:00.
Yeah, you can leave. I was telling you. I think you joined just now. I told
you. No, sir. Like, there was an internet problem, so I guess.
Okay. You can proceed anyhow. I'll finish this part and then do it. You can proceed for the next lecture.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So this is what is pitch. So I have my m vector. I have my r vector. So modulus of r vector. Also, I can find out what is this pitch. So pitch is by definition, if you take a screw and if I turn the screw by one revolution, how much is the lead, the axial displacement, is what I have to find out. So the screws are of single strand screw, double strand screw, triple strand screw, like that. So n into number of pitches, what is that lead? So pitch is referring to the axial distance between a corresponding point in the two adjacent screws. So if your wrench is like, a wrench is something that you could see. What is it? It's a screwdriver, is a wrench. So I give a pressure as well as I turn it. Right? So that is the wrench. So if we see that I give a pressure and I can look at that as a screw. So there are threads. So adjacent thread, the corresponding point distance axially is what is pitch. That's what is the meaning here. What is this P? So I can find out that for this problem. Right? And I can also have this now. So how do I reduce this to a wrenches? Now I have to find out what is this parallel component. This I have found out. And I can get the perpendicular component after that by taking this vector on this side. So I would be able to get this. So getting this is easier because it's pitch times r. So pitch is given by this, which is all data known now, this problem. So if I have this in hand, I can get what is r cross r. So what is r cross r? Now it's going to be moment vector, that's to resultant couple vector, minus pitch times r vector. So I'll get this vector and I can find this r vector simply considering its position vector. So I would shift this force resultant and the collinear couple parallel component to another point, say point P, whose coordinate is xp, yp, comma 0. So 2 points and one point should be 0. So if I take like this, I would be able to get. So this position vector is what? The point P is a new point I replace so that this component can be eliminated, and that would only be the system of collinear force and the couple called a wrench. So that to get, I consider this xp, yp point from point B. So position vector R should be here, R, B, P. So R, B, P cross R vector is what I could get it here. So on one side I know the vector, the other side I do not know these two unknowns, so that I can find out this coordinate. At that coordinate I would have only the resultant force and the collinear couple, and this perpendicular component of the couple would be eliminated. So that's my final reduction as a wrench. So this I will leave it as a homework that you would be finishing it and then confirm this understanding of what you mean by wrench. That is the final reduction that is possible in a space force general force system, space general force system. So with that note, I complete today's lecture and I download your attendance. If you have any doubts, you can ask. Otherwise, we will disperse.
So excuse me, sir. So my next class has been started, sir. Can I, you know?
Yeah, I have announced that.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So you can proceed, and next class we have on Wednesday 1 to 2. Right?
Fine. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So if you do not have any doubts, I'll stop recording.